All right, welcome back. It's still the Breakfast and Plus TV Africa, and we're still focusing on security vis-a-vis all that's happening in Kaduna State with the release of the Afaka student and, of course, issues of banditry, kidnapping, and, of course, you know, talking of paying, you know, ransom, and, of course, the issue of, you know, amnesty as well. And we are being joined by a popular cleric, Sheikh Ahmed Gumi, this morning to look at all of the issues yet again. Good morning, Sheikh. Many thanks for joining us on Plus Breakfast.
Good morning, Sheikh Gumi. Good to have you.
Good morning. It's a pleasure for me.
All right. First of all, let's say congratulations to the Kaduna State Government and, of course, indeed all the family friends of the students who got released on Wednesday. Can you run us through exactly what happened? Reports say it was an intervention by you and, of course, former President Olusegun Obasanjo. What are the issues, and was any money paid to secure the release of the students?
Okay, first of all, we are all happy that it has come to a very pleasant conclusion that no life was lost. And this is the most important thing. Chief Olusegun Obasanjo, being a former president, a man of connection, we realize has since been concerned about what is happening in this country, and has been trying to make contacts to see if he can get people who will make him understand what is happening actually. And this is one of the good qualities of a leader, to ask people who should know. And this is how we came about going to see him and trying to explain to him what is happening, and also joining the initiative to see that we bring an end to banditry, kidnappings, and general insecurity, in especially the northern region and Nigeria as a whole, because it's something that now has affected every region of the country. It's becoming pandemic. So this is how it came about. We had two meetings, and we formed a committee that will try to get into contact with the relevant people to see how we can get all kidnapped persons released from the, from this kidnapping or detention.
All right, Sheikh Gumi, can you confirm to me if any ransom was paid to the bandits for the release of the 27 schoolgirls and boys?
Yes, I can say there is no ransom paid, but in the sense, look at it this way. These people have abducted children. They are demanding for 500 million naira and nothing else. This is, there was a standoff between them and the government. And we understand they are attacking the government because they are attacking a government institution. And the money, the bar is very high because they were expecting something from the government. And there was a standoff. So we went in between, negotiate with them, try to see that they distribute and free these children. So in negotiations, you don't ask what happened behind the door. Since the parents paid nothing and the government paid nothing. So as far as we are concerned, no ransom is paid.
All right, Sheikh Gumi, you talked about negotiations with the bandits. Specifically, can you tell us what their demands were, you know, that necessitated the release of these students? From what we read in the dailies and from other reports, a particular bandit was exchanged for the release of these students. Can you confirm to us?
You see, the process of reconciliation and negotiation should not be in the open, especially, as I've told you now, only God knows how many people are there in detention. Because when we were in Niger State, one of the bandits' leaders stood up when we were discussing with, because they gathered themselves, saying, telling his own colleagues, look, if we are really serious about this matter of peace, he said we should release the thousands. He mentioned thousands of those kidnapped in the bush. So we realize there are a lot of Nigerians who are unprivileged, they are still there. We don't like to speak in specific details the way the press would like it, because the life of other Nigerians is at stake. I'm telling you, as I'm talking of now, But now we have seen a way to solve this problem by engagement, by dialogue, by all possible means. We have a politician who said when the Chibok girls were abducted in 2014 or 15, he said the government should do anything possible, anything without any exception, anything possible to get lives. We're after lives now, we're not after the means which we secure lives. So this is the only thing we can tell the population, Nigerians, to be patient with us. We free, inshallah, we free all the captives.
Sheikh Gumi, in time past, you've talked about, you know, your stance regarding terrorism, banditry, kidnapping, and all of that. And recently, in an interview with one of the newspapers, you said that one of the reasons why terrorism persists in Nigeria is because bandits are being marginalized. Could you explain what you might mean by that statement?
Yes, you see, that's why I always continue to praise Chief Olusegun Obasanjo. In fact, I didn't know that we have such a great leader until just recently. Unfortunately, I was one of his ardent critics when he was in government. I didn't even know, get close to him. But now, after getting close to him, I realized how much we missed this gentleman. This is the kind of leader we want, who wants to go into the depth, not just to stop at newspaper headings, which are almost inevitably deceiving. And they don't really reflect the true happening in the issue. What I want people to understand is this banditry is a tip of an iceberg of a myriad of problems that are happening in our forest. It's not only the bandits that are there. They are a big population, maybe amounting to almost 9 million by a rough estimate by studies on nomads. 9 million people held hostage by armed bandits. So when you want to fight bandits, behind them, a big population of nomads, you end up killing more and more innocent people than actually the bandits. That's why approaching this issue has to be really studied, intellectually executed, and there are many ways of doing it intellectually. And I hope with the recent initiative and alliance with people of understanding, I think we are coming to see the end of this banditry. We just need cooperation of the press, not to be sensational, not to be trying to take side in this issue. The issue is more than just banditry, as I've said, it's just a tip of an iceberg. The kidnappings are an end result of the struggle and fight under which need to be addressed.
Sheikh Gumi, I'm not sure I heard you right, but did you just say that 9 million people are in captivity in Nigeria?
Nigerian forests, specifically, you said.
Yes, I am having some problems here.
Okay, we just need you to confirm what you... Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay.
Yeah, I need to go ahead.
Yes, Sheikh Gumi, if you can hear me, you mentioned a statement that I need you to, you know, clarify. Did you say there are 9 million people in forests in Nigeria who are in captivity?
Yes, it's just like when there's a military junta that takes overthrow a democratic government. It's just a few military officers taking a whole country into ransom when you have a military coup. It's just like that. Armed men in the forest, I said nomadics are almost 9.4 million nomads in our forest. So when you think the forest is only occupied by bandits, then you have a misconception. There are civilians there, but they are also under the influence or command, or they are, I can say, they are also prisoners under these bandits. So until when you dismantle that association, then I think you will be able to effectively tackle the problem of banditry.
Okay, I don't understand where you're coming from now. But really, Sheikh Gumi, you seem to have advocated for amnesty for bandits in recent time. But don't you think that people who kidnap people who kidnap students, who kill women and children, don't you think they deserve to be punished under the law?
Okay, since you have understood the parable, let's go back to my parable. Maybe you can understand it better. A young officer took over government, forced the population into submitting to the authority. Then suddenly somebody said, let's negotiate with this junta, military junta, so that they give power back. And then somebody will tell me, no, they have tested power. They will not give power. No, when there is pressure in the right place, they will hand over power to the civilians. So this is what I'm saying. These bandits, we need to follow them and approach them and see their psychology and see the etiology. What causes banditry? When we put all this together, then the approach which the nation can do is to circumspect the bandits and somehow intellectually remove power from them. But you can't do them by facing them face to face. Face to face will cause a lot of collateral damage. You damage yourself and damage them. And not them, you know, the civilians that is under them. In fact, the environmental catastrophe that is happening will be so, cannot be bearable. And also, you know, and now more than 20% of agricultural land now is under their influence. People are not farming anymore. So we fear that hunger may eventually come. And I can also add here, just recently, 2 days ago, I was able to reconcile between two families.
Right, we seem to be having a connectivity issue with the Sheikh. Hello, Sheikh, are you still there?
All right, we'll apologize for that. We'll try and reconnect to the Sheikh. You know, really important questions we need to ask regarding his stance on the amnesty. You know,
and the marginalization that he talked about.
Yes, he says the bandits have been neglected. Recently, in an interview, he said the government should make a budgetary allocation or provision for the bandits. And we need to really understand where he's coming from. Sheikh Gumi, thanks for joining us.
All right, Sheikh, let's get back to. I still want to talk more concerning the issue. Can you hear me, Sheikh? I want to still talk about the issue of marginalization.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, I still want to talk about the issue of marginalization. Marginalization of the bandits, like you have said. You know, a lot of people, different sects in the country, have claimed to have been marginalized. A lot of people calling for self-determination, cessation, and all of that. Don't you think that if everyone claims to marginalize in Nigeria, we have like a big issue in our hands? Should all of them be given amnesty, so to speak? And don't you think all of this just stems from the issue of bad governance that we have had over the years in the country?
Yes, you are 100% correct. It's bad governance that led to this problem. What you see, when a particular population is totally neglected, absolutely total. Let me tell you an example. The 2020-21 budget has nothing for the nomadics. Well, I call them nomadics. Let's remove the bandits. The bandits is just the leaders of the nomadics now. Just like when you have a junta controlling an area. Look at the civilians. You know, when Saddam Hussein was alleged to have weapons of mass destruction, and there was a sanction on Iraq for almost 2 years, and Iraqs were faced with hunger. But Iraqis are not Saddam Hussein. You see how they did with him when they caught him. This is the same thing. Now our forest is containing a lot of nomadics, which I have said about 9.4 million by study, which is an estimation. And they are under the command of these bandits, the militant bandits, they are controlling them. So now, what percentage of our budget goes to them? They have children, they have women, no hospital, no schools, nothing they get from the budget. And I said just previously that I was able to reconcile. All there is a group that reconciled themselves. I only came to bring them to open to see that there are good things happening on the ground. But for 2 months now, they have reconciled themselves that this year there is going to be famine. So one of the Fulani men who stood up in my mosque was explaining that one of the advantages of this peace is that when their women are sick, at least they can get a health official to come to their area to attend to their women. Just imagine the bush. This health attendant you are talking about is not any way qualified. It's just something who maybe is by, it's not a professional They don't even have professional health care.
Sheikh Gumi.
That's why Doctors Without Borders came to me. They are so concerned about the people in the bush. Doctors Without Borders, they are concerned about Nigerian population in the bush coming to say, let's follow you so that we go and look at the health status of these people. Doctors Without Borders are not Nigerian. What is the Nigerian government thinking about its own people in the bush without any medical care, without schools? And when you leave a big population like that without education, what do you expect? Do you expect them to be manufacturing chocolate to be distributed to us?
Sheikh Gumi,
apologies
to Button, but we understand where you're coming from, you know, talking about the infrastructure debt in those areas. But that, many people argue, is the responsibility of the state government. You know, if, for example, it's in Kano State or let's say Kaduna State, and you're saying there is no hospital, you know, for healthcare, there are no schools, that's the responsibility of the state government to provide those things for that community, not just to provide that for bandits. So why, you know, I need to ask,
provision right away from the central government. The federal government is the one that holds the states. They pay for everything. So if the federal government will make an allocation for rural development, rural education, then there won't be any problem.
Sheikh Gumi, the states
are doing terribly, terribly bad. The local governments are doing worse even than them because they are closer to them. They can even organize them, as we are trying to do now, to organize them to self-help. Let them help themselves. They have cows. This is what we are trying to do. But this basic logic, as you see it, is not simple with them because there are people who are generally unlettered. People, they don't even, have any education for them to think, or even a unified leadership that can take care of their problems.
Sheikh Gumi, I wonder how, you know, you might be asking for the government to set aside in the national budget money to give bandits who kill people, who kidnap people, who go to schools and who, you know, kidnap school children. I really don't understand where you're coming from when, you know, like I've mentioned,
let me explain to you. These bandits that do the mischief, they are less than 0.11% of nomads. I'm not asking for a ministry of banditry. I'm asking for a ministry of nomadic affairs. You should understand? So we should withdraw the carpet from their feet. The bandits are the just small tip of people who are armed, and they're using that arm to suppress a bigger population who have children. You see, I was in a forest. I saw two young girls. Maybe after I finish, I can send you the clip I recorded from them. Barefooted, very young girls. You see, they don't have opportunity to be an anchor like you. They are just walking around. So when I asked them, where do you get your water from? They showed me a stream, a dirty stream, where the animals also take water. This is the situation. I said, government should quickly come in.
So Sheikh Gumi, you want...
In 2008, the then governor of Central Bank, there was a conference here in Kaduna.
Seem to be losing him again. So, now, but then again, I wonder, Aneta, if a Ministry of Nomadic Affairs. Is what we need, you know, to sort of all of these issues of banditry, you know, in Nigeria, because we've talked about governance and extra budgetary, you know, allocations. At the end of the day, most of those monies are just sunk away, and there are no, you know, immediate accountability for them all. All right, the Sheikh is back. Let's try and conclude this thought now. But Sheikh, in your opinion right now, you said there needs to be a Ministry of Nomadic Affairs if we need to tackle the growing spate of insecurity in Nigeria. But is that really the way forward, judging by the issues of corruption and governance and too much cost of governance in Nigeria? Is that what we should be talking about at this moment to keep our children safe? Of course, Nigerians safe generally.
Yes, you see, when you neglect... When a student who didn't read his exams, he had a whole year to read his exams. And then when it came to 1 week, then he realized that he has to read. He has to go back and read what he's supposed to read for the whole year. Something we are supposed to be doing before, we didn't do. We must do it. Whether it's time is short or not, whether we're going to fail or not, it's a must. Nigeria must do that. It must look into the fight of the nomadics who are now under the spell of the bandits. And we are trying to see, put a gap between them and the bandits, because you see, if you put a gap between them, then the bandits can easily be
Shegumi, if you're saying the government should create a Ministry of Nomadic Affairs to cater to the needs of bandits, would that not be the government of Nigeria itself sponsoring and funding terrorism? I mean, how do you see it?
I didn't say Ministry of Bandit Affairs.
Nomadic Affairs,
I said
you said.
Ministry of Nomadic Affairs.
But the bandits are nomads, are they not? But are the bandits not nomads?
You see, when you cater for them?
Shegumi, you said bandits are the leaders of the nomads. You made that statement earlier on. So if you're saying
they are not leaders, they are not leaders. They are suppressing the nomads. As now they are terrorizing us. Me and you, we are terrorized by the same bandits. You can see where bandits can come and take children of a federal institution for 56 days.
Sheikh, don't you think
under the sky?
Sheikh, don't you think this will be sending the wrong notion?
Nobody can do anything. You and me and the what you call it, nomadics, are also under the influence of the bandits. So how do we tackle the problem?
Sheikh, if I should just get a word in edgewise right now. The thing is, right now, if we created the Ministry of Nomadic Affairs just to appease, the militants and the bandits in the north, don't you think pockets of other groups might just spring up, maybe from the southwest or the southeast or south-south, you know, renewed militancy again in the southern part of the country, calling for some sort of ministry to take care of their own issues at that level?
Yes, that's why we have Minister of Niger Delta Affairs. That's why we have Northeastern Commission to look directly into the problem of Boko Haram. The same thing, I'm not talking for something new, but the point is, let's do it. The Niger Delta detention has reduced from 100, Northeastern Commission has also reduced the influence of Boko Haram. So why not apply it also to the banditry? Why not? And then secondly, people are saying if everybody who is having agitation will take off arms. No, not every group of Nigerians can take off arms. Impossible. These bandits were able to take off arms because they had a sanctuary. They have a castle where they can hide themselves from the
force. All right.
That is the push.
All right, Sheikh Gumi.
Nigeria has the
All right, thank you, Sheikh Gumi.
So you see, we have to tackle this problem as we tackle the Niger Delta problem, as we tackle the Boko Haram this Northeastern Commission looking into the IDPs, because millions of people are displaced by Boko Haram.
All right, thank you, Sheikh Gumi. That's as much as we indeed have time for today. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. So we'll just have to cross our fingers, watch and see if the government would maybe set up a ministry for nomadic affairs. We'd follow up on that as time goes on.
And now some group of criminals or suspected criminals will just spring up somewhere and say that they are terrorized and they are marginalized and they need their own ministry.
Let us know on social media at Plus TV Africa. Would you want the government to create a Ministry of Nomadic Affairs so the terrorists and bandits can be pacified to stop, you know, the acts of killing and kidnapping of young children? Is at Plus TV Africa once again. Thank you very much for joining us on The Breakfast. It's been a ride of security, insecurity, kidnapping, banditry, following the good news of the release of the 27 students of the Federal College of Forestry Mechanization in Afaka, Kaduna State. We spoke to Samuel Arawan, Minister of Security and Internal Home Affairs in the state, Sheikh Gumi here, as well as Mr. Kenneth.
However elusive the government was from Kaduna State. Well, that's the size of the show. Well, we must say a very big thank you to all of you who have stayed with us all through Monday to Friday. My name is Justin Akadonye.
And I am Annetta Felix. Have a great weekend.